having a wonderful week. If you're not, you're in the right place, because God has a word for you today.
Amen.
We are so excited to have all of our mothers in the room. If you're a mother, would you stand up? All right, let's give our mothers a hand. That's one of the hardest jobs in the world, being a mother, and especially these days. So we are excited that you're here, and we pray God speaks to your heart. Let's have a word of prayer. Father, we thank you so much for this beautiful, hot day. Yeah. And Lord, we just thank you for the rain you've sent to us. We thank you for your tender watch care over us, Lord. And Father, we know every good thing that we can name in our life has come from you, especially our mothers. There is no one on the earth that exemplifies more of your love and your patience and your gentleness and your long-suffering than a Christian mother does. And Lord, we just pray today as we take note, special note of our mothers, that you will bless them in a special way. Father, we thank you for this day. We pray the Holy Spirit will move in our congregation, that you will fill us, that you will cleanse us, that you will transform us into everything you've called us to be. Lord, we love you and we commit this day to you. In Jesus' wonderful name we pray. And everyone said,
Amen.
Amen. Oh, Brother Orton.
Good morning.
Morning.
We're going to give four little massages here this morning out to the some of the mothers. We didn't know how many mothers would be here. We've got one for everybody. But I think you'll get one when you go out the door, but it won't be a massage. We're going to give one now to the mother that's the oldest in church. Or is there anybody over 85 years or old? They all raise your hand. Oh, we got one. Billy, come on up here.
I'm not the only one over 85.
Annie Jo. No, wait a minute. Annie Jo, are you 90?
No.
Well, Billy's 90. I know how old she is.
I told him not to, so he's doing it.
Billy's the oldest.
Yeah, mom's the oldest.
I don't think we need to take any praise for being a mom.
Come on, Billy, get you.
Come on down. I've had it so many years, I think some of
them are going to be it. They got it. Well, there's two in here.
Oh, there's two.
They're going to pin them on.
Yeah,
Elizabeth, pin them on. You put them on there. Elizabeth's going to pin them on for
you. All right. There you go.
Okay, we're going to give one now to the youngest mother here in church. The youngest mother.
20.
Anybody 20 years or younger, please, you're going to have to raise your hand. Anybody 25 or younger here? Nobody 25 or younger? We're getting old, aren't we? Anybody 30 or younger here in church? That's a mother.
I'm
31. You what? Anybody 31? Okay, we're going to, if you've already got one of these, you're not going to get the second one, okay? Do we have, how many here below 35 years young or younger? Raise your hand. Got
Amber's got it.
Amber? Okay.
Come on down, Amber. Yeah. There we go.
I don't know what color.
You just like the right
time. There you go.
Okay. While they pinning that on, say a little time. We're going to give one now to the mother that's been a Christian the longest. The Christian the longest. Has anybody been 60 years or a Christian longer? Don't have to raise your hand, okay? 70 years or longer, raise your hand. Got one, two.
75
or longer, raise your hand.
Oh, got Barbara's got that. Oh, no, wait. Bobby.
Bobby, Barbara, keep going.
Keep going, 80.
80 or longer.
Well, I'm 86 and I was 9 years old, so I don't know.
Yeah.
79.
Yeah,
79
years.
79 years. Anybody 79 years been a Christian 79 years? Raise your hand. 78. 77.
Oh, Barbara's 79.
You 79, Barbara?
Come on, Barbara.
Come on. gonna give one out to mother that's got the most children in church.
In church.
In church.
In here, this church.
How many here, anybody got three children in church? Raise your hand, please. Your children, not grandchildren, but children.
Okay, never mind.
You got three? Somebody got three in church? Anybody got two children in church? Got one, I know it's got two. Okay.
All right, Daisy.
Daisy, come on.
Come on, Daisy.
Thank you, and happy Mother's Day to all the mothers.
Yeah.
Let's stand and take our hymn and turn to page 244.
Seed is planted in this mother, and the seed grows.
Yes.
It's born, and just automatically that baby is nourished and taken care of by that mother.
Yes.
And it nurses and it grows. And all throughout the life, these mothers take care of these babies.
Yes.
And Lord, we just recognize this today. And we just praise them for this, each and
yes.
every mother here.
Yes.
Lord, we just praise for you, for our church, and just ask that you be with our church and just give us
yes.
wisdom,
Lord.
Yes. And give us knowledge and let us go forth in your direction.
Yes.
Lord, we just pray that you will bless this offering today.
Yes.
Just take it and use it for your glory.
Yes.
We ask this in Jesus' name.
Jesus
Amen.
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 birthdays or anniversaries this past week? No birthdays, no anniversaries? So let's stand and greet one another in the Lord.
Amen. That gave birth to their children.
Yes.
Lord, as I said this morning, early, all those that are protesting our Supreme Court justices at their homes, Lord, a mother gave birth to them and they're wanting to kill them. Lord, I don't understand people that want to destroy and murder an unborn child. Lord, that's a life that you put in somebody to give birth to. And I think of the great lady that sang with Brother Billy Graham, Ethel Waters. She was a product of rape. And what the wonders she did for you.
Yes.
Lord, and we don't know how many people that could have done wonders for you that are,
yes,
are with you in heaven, yes, because of choices. Mm. Lord, I lift up these that have been mentioned this morning.
Yes.
Lord, I lift up Hunter with his tonsils and his,
yes,
hernia he has now, Lord. We just pray for healing upon his body. Give him strength each day, Lord. Lord, I lift up Barbara. She has unspoken prayers, Lord. And Father, I just pray you'll give her answers to those, yes, unspoken prayers, Lord. Watch over and take care of her each day, Lord.
Yes.
Father, I lift up Bill Bush.
Yes.
Lord, I pray that he'll open his eyes and come to you, Lord.
Yes.
And we'll come visit our church, Lord.
Yes.
Come with his son.
Yes.
Watch over and take care of him, Father.
Yes.
We're not going to give up, Lord.
Right.
Lord, I lift up Della with the cancer she has, Lord. We,
yes,
pray for healing. Pray for your will to be done in our life, Lord.
Yes.
Lord, I thank you for everything you've already done.
Yes.
And Lord, the healing you've already performed, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
And we don't always recognize the healing you've already performed, Lord.
Yes.
But Lord, we just lift her up at this time, Lord.
Yes.
Lord, I lift up Gustavo.
Yes.
Lord, pray for healing.
Yes, Lord. Help.
Lord, give him strength, Lord. Each day. Lord, I lift up Craig Nolan. And he's going back to the hospital, Lord. And I pray it's not the same thing it was before, Lord, but if it is, we just pray, Lord, that he'll come to know you in a real and mighty way, Lord.
Yes.
I know he's been witness to. Lord, I just lift him up at this time, Lord. Father, I lift up Weston. Lord, we give you the praise that he's doing so well after this kidney removal. Lord, he's on dialysis, Lord, but we praise you. He's back in school.
Yes.
Lord, with his friends. He has a good outlook, Lord, but we just lift him and his mother, Lauren, up as she gives the kidney of hers to him on June 8th.
Yes.
Lord, we just pray that you'll guide the surgeon's hands.
Yes.
And they'll be on the well road to recovery very quickly and be back doing the things that they normally do, Lord.
Yes.
Father, I lift up Frankie Philbin, Lord. That this bad car wreck is in, brain damage, Lord. Father, just pray for healing. Give him strength. Pray, Lord, that this is not a severe damage, Lord. That it's a damage that can be fixed, Lord. And Lord, watch over and take care of him, Father. I pray, Lord, that he knows you.
Yes.
Lord, at this time, Lord.
Yes.
If he doesn't, I pray he comes to know you in a real and mighty way. Now, Lord, we looked up Marietta.
Yes.
Lord, as they deal with the loss of their daughter, Father, give them a peace.
Yes.
Lord, give them a peace about the man that did the murder.
Yes.
And that's what's so hard to forgive, Lord. But as Christians, that's what we're supposed to do. Lord, it's terrible that these things happen.
Yes.
Lord, but I left them in your hands.
Yes.
And pray, Lord, that you're going to be a witness in all of this, Lord. Yes. They'll come to know you and have a total peace because of you. Lord, I lift their services up today. If there be a lost soul here, I pray they come to know you in a real and mighty way, Lord.
Yes.
Father, without you, we have no hope. Lord, and Father, we know that when we accept you as our personal Savior, we have eternal salvation.
Yes.
And Lord, those that don't ever accept you, Lord, they're bound for sinner's hell. Lord, and there won't be any peace there.
Mm.
Father, I thank you for everything you've done.
Yes.
I lift up our church to you. Give us guidance and give us strength. Let us do your will. In Christ's name, I ask it all. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Let's take our hymns and turn to page 438. Call stand.
Of my heart, shadows dispelling with joy.
334.
I did not make it, no, it is me.
Because we realize Jesus walks through every church and he knows what we're doing well and he knows where we fall short. And you know, as long as we're in this flesh, we're going to fall short. But we need to keep our eyes on the Word, our eyes upon the Lord, and continue on the best we can until we meet him. I want to read a little description before we get into the church at Sardis that John MacArthur wrote about, which I thought was really good. It says, the vast distances of interstellar space are unimaginably immense. The nearest stars to us are trillions of miles away. Those large distances have forced astronomers to come up with an appropriate measurement unit, the light year. One light year equals the distance that light traveling at more than 186,000 miles per second travels in 1 year. And that is 6 trillion miles in 1 year. You know, that just blows the mind. The enormous distance to even the nearest stars presents an interesting possibility. If a star 30 years away from the Earth exploded and died 5 years ago, we would not be able to tell it by looking at it for another 25 years. Woo! So in other words, this star blew up and it would take 25 years for us even to see that it blew up. It's so far away. Though no longer in existence, the light from the star would go on shining as if nothing had changed. That illustration perfectly sums up the situation in many churches. They still shine with the reflected light of a brilliant past. Looking at them from a distance, one might think nothing had changed. Yet the spiritual darkness of false teaching and sinful living have extinguished the light on the inside, though some of their reputation may still remain. Such a church was the church at Sardis. It was reputed to be alive, but when the Lord Jesus pronounced it, he said it was dead. Now, it would be a horrible thing to belong to a church that is dead. And you know, that's the churches where the Holy Spirit stamps on the front door, Ichabod. The Spirit has departed. And what would cause the Holy Spirit or the Lord Jesus Christ to look at a church in that way? Well, we're going to see at Sardis, they greatly compromised what the Word of God said. They were open to willful sin in going against what God says. What God calls sin is sin, no matter what we may think. And we live in a society today that more and more sin seems to be exalted as wonderful. We know, because we are Christians, that what our world system calls good can be very dark and bleak indeed. You know, all this transgender movement and the way that it is being brought to the forefront in our schools and by our teachers, some teachers, that are pushing these young people to make decisions about their gender. And oftentimes to push them to where they even go through surgical procedures, to where there's no turning back should they change their mind, is utterly ridiculous. We know young people do not have the facility to understand what they're going to think in 5 years, let alone 5 days. We know teenagers bounce back and forth and all over the place. You know, I once heard a parent say, when kids become teenagers, you put them in a barrel, you seal the lid until they reach 21 years of age, and then you let them out. Because it's a wild and crazy time, and we all understand that. There's one song we sing when we have prayer meeting on Saturdays that asks God, Lord, don't remember the sins of my youth. And brother, I can tell you, I was wild as blue blazes, like many of you were. But it's a struggle. So here we see that in the solar system, we can look at something and not even realize it's been destroyed many years ago. So turn, if you would, to Revelation chapter 3. And I want us to look at what the Lord says about what is going on in Sardis. To the angel of the church in Sardis write, He who has the seven spirits of God and the seven stars says this, I know your deeds, that you have a name, that you are alive, but you are dead. Woo. You know, if some other people came into your church and called it dead, you might would excuse that and say they didn't know what they were talking about. But when it is the head of the church, the Lord Jesus Christ, that walks through the aisles of the church and says, you know what, you're dead, then you've got a big problem. So let's look at what else the Lord says. He says, wake up and strengthen the things that remain, which were about to die, for I have not found your deeds completed in my sight. You know, I can remember through the years when Lenita and I both worked, and sometimes my schedule would be that I would be able to go and work a little bit later than her. And how frustrated I would be when she would start her alarm clock an hour before we needed to get up. And what she would do, she would hit the snooze over and over and over. It drove me crazy. But that's the way she woke up. She would do it little by little by little. Well, you know what? Sometimes the church needs to quit hitting the snooze button. Quit just rolling with the flow. We talked about last week, the Apostle Paul sent a letter to the church at Corinth that had openly accepted sin in their congregation. And he was speaking to how much damage it was doing. You know, private sin that nobody sees but you and the Lord is one thing. But open sin is very detrimental to the church of God. Amen? Because, now we don't have a lot of young people, but young people that see older members doing wicked things, and they know it's happening, and nobody dare says a thing, then they take that as, well, that's okay, I can do it too. And we know sin affects everyone. You know, we can sit there and say, well, my sin shouldn't bother you. You keep it to yourself and I'll keep it to myself. But when a husband or wife cheats on the other, that not only affects the one doing it, but the mate that has to endure it, and all the kids. And when there is a divorce because of that sin, what does it do to the family? It rips it in two. That's right. It is utterly devastating. So we need to stop. And you know what wisdom is? Wisdom is seeing beyond what you're being tempted to do and looking at what will be the consequences if I do that. Boy, wouldn't it be a better world that we would live in if people would do that?
Amen.
Because
Amen.
We know the devastating effect that it has on all of us when we sin. And you know, for children, sometimes they never get over their parents going in separate directions and remarrying.
That's right.
Now, if you've done that, I'm not here to throw rocks at you. We've all made mistakes and we've all fallen short. And there's only one unforgivable sin, as far as I know. That's blasphemy against the Holy Spirit. So, but Jesus walked through this church and he pointed out the fact that God was going to depart that church, and probably already had, because they were dead. Now I want us to look at another picture of how sad it is when God departs and we still think he's there. Turn, if you will, to Judges. Judges 16. And I want us to look at a very familiar story in the book of Judges. And it is about Samson and Delilah. Judges 16:16. Now, we know that Samson, who is a judge of Israel, was a pretty wicked guy. And if it enticed his flesh, he did it. And he's what we would call a ladies' man. So he was probably pretty muscular, pretty good looking, and he was enticed by different women to do wicked things. So here we have Delilah, who was one of the Philistines, and the Philistines hated the Jews, and they were wanting to find out what Samson's weakness was. so they can attack him and bring him into bondage and destroy him. So here Delilah has tried three or four different times to get Samson to give her the secret of his strength. At one meeting, when he had been in with a young lady, all the Philistines were outside waiting to attack and destroy Samson. But what they didn't realize was the strength of Samson. He came out of that house, he carried the post of the city, the gate, he shot it up to the mountaintop, and they understood they're lucky if they left there alive, because he had massive strength, as far as we would describe strength. And so Delilah was pestering him to find out. Then she said to him, verse 15 of chapter 16, "How can you say I love you when your heart is not with me? You have deceived me these three times and have not told me where your great strength is." It came about when she pressed him daily with her words and urged him that his soul was annoyed to death. Now, let's have a raise of hands. Men, have you ever been annoyed at your wife? No, I know that don't happen. You know, I've learned a long time ago when Lanita's telling me something, if I can just nod my head and say yes, I'm all right.
That means so you didn't listen,
though. I think a lot of men do that. That's exactly right. I didn't listen. It came about, verse 16, when she pressed him daily with her words and urged him that his soul was annoyed to death. So he told her that was all that was in his heart and said to her, "A razor has never come on my head, for I have been a Nazarite to God from my mother's womb." In other words, from his mother's womb, he was set apart to be a Nazarite priest or a judge, like he was. So, and part of that vow was they were going to have long hair. And so, he had this Nazarite vow that a razor has never come on my head, for I am a Nazarite to God from my mother's womb. If I am shaved, then my strength will leave me, and I will become weak and be like any other man. When Delilah saw that he had told her all that was in his heart, she sent and called the lords of the Philistines, saying, "Come up once more, for he has told me all that is in his heart." Then the lords of the Philistines came up to her and brought the money in their hands that they had promised her. She made him sleep on her knees and called for a man and had him shaved off the seven locks of his hair. Then she began to afflict him. Now, I don't know what was going on there, but she was afflicting him, and his strength left him. She said, "The Philistines are upon you, Samson." And he awoke from his sleep and said, this was to himself, "I will go out as at other times and shake myself free." But he did not know that the Lord had departed from him. Now, isn't that interesting? He didn't realize God wasn't in him anymore. He had sinned to the extent and broken his vow that the Holy Spirit did the Ichabod thing and departed from him. Now, look what happened. "The Philistines are upon you," Samson, verse 21. "Then the Philistines seized him and gouged out his eyes. And they brought him down to Gaza and bound him with bronze chains. And he was a grinder in the prison. However, the hair of his head began to grow again after it was shaved off." So, and we know the rest of the story, that he was blinded for some period of time. His hair grew back and God let him regain his strength. And he destroyed the temple where they were worshiping all the Philistines. And it says he killed more in death than he had ever killed when he was alive. But the part I want us to focus on is he went outside and shook himself like always, but he didn't realize God had departed. Now, in churches, many times you will find, especially in older congregations, they had their glory years when they were reaching out in the community, where they were blessing the community with different services. Maybe they gave them food. Maybe they gave them clothes. Maybe they helped them pay an electric bill when it came due. Whatever it was, the churches were vibrant and they were walking in the power of the Holy Spirit. But unbeknownst to them, little by little, sin encroached upon the congregation. And instead of doing what God says to do biblically, to go to the person in private and tell them, brother, I love you, but this is wickedness that you're involved in. And then if they won't listen, you take someone else from the church with you and you witness to them. Because let's be honest, who wants sin to destroy their walk with the Lord? I don't know if anybody that is a Christian would want that to happen. Amen?
Amen.
So, we must love each other enough that we are willing to tell the truth in love. And just like I talked about last week, if I was walking in open sin, if you really loved me, you would tell me. And you would talk to me about it and counsel me and help me. You know, in the Christian life, we never enter into judgment to hurt. We enter into judgment to help. And brothers and sisters, but by the grace of God, there goes I. We never know. Sin is always crouching at the door. That's why we must be vigilant to deal with it quickly and to turn from it and to walk in obedience to the Lord. Okay, so turn back to Revelation 3 then. And let's look at what else the Lord had to say to this church at Sardis. So he tells them in verse 2 to wake up because they're about to die. So remember, verse 3, what you have received and heard, and keep it and repent. Therefore, if you do not wake up, I will come like a thief, and you will not know at what hour I will come to you. But you have a few people in Sardis who have not soiled their garments, and they will walk with me in white, for they are worthy. Now, isn't it interesting what he brings up? There is always a spiritual remnant within each church that is passionate about their walk with God. Amen?
Amen?
I wish it was the whole church that was always passionate about their walk with God, but it seldom is. And we're going to see that even with the nation of Israel, we know that as we study prophecy, the day is approaching to where God is going to bring to an end the church age. And what is he going to do with the church? He's going to raise them up and meet them in the sky. The graveyards that have Christians, their bodies are going to come out of the ground. And as we're going up, we're going to be transformed into a glorified body. And so we shall always be with the Lord. But when that happens, there's going to be 7 years left on the earth to where God will enter into judgment with the nations that have rejected Jesus Christ. And we know by and large, it's a wide road. It's a broad gate that leads to destruction. And most people are on it. God said, it's a narrow road. It's a narrow gate. that leads to salvation. And few are those who find it. You know, today, I would be remiss if I didn't encourage you. Make sure you're on the narrow road. Make sure you're dealing with sin in your life. You have God the Holy Spirit who empowers you to overcome sin. But you know what you have to have? You have to have faith that He will do it. And then you have to ask Him to do it. You know, I remember when I used to cuss a lot. Not like they do today, but cuss a lot. And then there came a day in my life when I understood. That was impacting my testimony. The words that were coming out of my mouth. That's what people listen to. And God says, from the well of your heart, so flow the issues of life. In other words, if you are speaking wickedness, then there's wickedness inside you. I had a day when I asked God, help me, Lord, to not cuss anymore. And by and large, the Lord has enabled me not to do that. And if I slip up, it's because I slipped into the flesh for that moment. But then I have to ask God to forgive me and restore me again to all that He wants me to be. We need to say good words. We need to have good actions that come out of our life. Did you know when God saved you and He knew you'd be here today, that He has different deeds He wants you to do? And all the time, you may see somebody run out of gas. Help them. You may see somebody that has a blown tire. Help them. Because those are deeds that God wants you to do in His name to glorify His kingdom. Amen. Let's pray. Father, I thank You for Your word today. We thank You for Your presence here in Your church. And King Jesus, we thank You that You are walking through Balzora Baptist Church right now. You see the good things, and You bring to mind the bad things. Lord, build Your church. Forgive us where we fail Thee. Give us Your vision and Your power to accomplish the deed You want us to do. And Lord, should there be anyone in our building today that they are not sure that they're on the narrow road that leads to heaven, Father, I pray right now You would open their eyes and open their hearts. Help them to step out in faith and to ask You to come into their life so that they can know that when they die, they're going to go to heaven. Father, You know every heart and every need. We pray in this moment, in this invitation, that You will glorify Your name. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Brother Paul?
308.
308.